So there I am, just hanging out at work, not doing anything, Wednesday afternoon, and then my phone beeps and look what it is. The NCAA has allowed athletes to profit off their name, image, and likeness. Just randomly, on the same day as Game 3 of the College World Series. It's the most bizarre thing that I can think of happening on some random Wednesday afternoon, and yet we somehow got it. The NCAA has actually done it. So let's take a look at this legislation, one of the biggest moves in the history of athlete rights in the NCAA, and let's actually take a look at what this might mean for college sports. So the fact that this just randomly happens on a Wednesday is absolutely crazy, but I think the reason why NCAA President Mark Emmert pretty much laid out there, he made no bones about the fact that the NCAA is very much intimidated by both legal actions taken that went all the way up to the Supreme Court. We've talked about that on previous videos on this channel, so go check them out if you haven't already seen them. We've done a few talking about NCAA v. Alston. But also, the NCAA was very intimidated by legislation happening on the state level that we saw first in California, which we've also made a video about, and in other states as well. The NCAA was clearly feeling the heat from multiple fronts, and they decided to finally allow nationwide, on all three division levels, athletes to make money off of their name, image, and likeness. So let's first talk about, what is name, image, and likeness? Well, it's pretty much exactly what it sounds. Name is your name, and so that could be your real name. So some famous athlete like LeBron James, who has big name recognition, he can sell the rights to his name. Or it can be a stage name, someone like Dwayne Johnson being The Rock. It's your image, so obviously what you look like, pictures of you, or the rights to draw you, or caricatures, or things like that. That's big for video games. We'll get to that in a second. And likeness, which again goes back to just being able to use your image and drawing and caricatures and things of that nature. That's essentially what this is. It's basically allowing athletes to take control of their own money-making apparatuses, let's say, what is recognizable about them that would allow them to actually make some money. There's an article in ESPN right now, which is very interesting because it actually details some of the things that athletes will now be able to do under this new legislation. And I've talked about a lot of these before, so let me just read for you word for word some of the examples that ESPN has come up with that athletes would now be allowed to do that they would have that they would not have been allowed to do before this legislation. So ESPN says the new rules will allow athletes to profit by monetizing social media accounts, signing autographs, teaching camps or lessons, starting their own businesses, and participating in advertising campaigns. Those are just the examples ESPN came up with, and I've come up with several more myself, and I'm sure you're all thinking of different ways that people can make money. Athletes can now do that. Pretty much the only thing that collegiate athletes can't do is receive money directly for playing their sports. So this is big. I mean, this is really, really big, because this is something that even as recently as last year, the NCAA had dug their heels in the ground. This was the line in the sand. This was the hill that they were going to die on, that athletes will not be allowed to do this. And then, oh, suddenly they're allowed to do this. Now, it's obvious that there was so much pressure put on the NCAA, they were not going to be able to hold on to the floodgates for very long. We knew that. It was just a matter of, would they go down with the sinking ship, or would they realize that the tides are changing and they have to do what they need to do in order to stay in power? This, to me, solidifies, maybe not solidifies, but it at least opens the possibility that the NCAA could still be around for the long term as the governing body of college sports. I was in the camp of someone who really, really believed that if the NCAA did not do something like this, the Power Five conferences would have broken away and started their own collegiate sports league. And I really didn't want that to happen, because there's a lot of issues if that were to happen. Because then you talk about non-conference games, and would they be allowed to play schools from the group of five, or what would happen to the NCAA tournament and basketball and baseball and softball, and what would happen to the college football playoff? There's so many questions that would be opened up if the Power Five were to break away. So to me, I would very much prefer that all these schools remained under the same umbrella. So right now, it seems like the NCAA has given themselves the opportunity to continue being that organization, to be the umbrella over all college football teams, or college sports teams, I should say. Now, for the athletes, this is huge. And if you are a collegiate athlete, congratulations to you, because this, to me, is exactly what should be happening. I am a free market capitalist. I absolutely believe that if you have earned the right to make money, if there is something about you that is special that someone will pay for in some regard, then you should absolutely be able to earn that money that you have earned by putting in all the work, by taking all the time, doing all the things that you have done in order to achieve the distinction of being a collegiate athlete. And the reason why I think this is great is because what it really does is it turns the money making over to the athletes themselves. So I really didn't want to get into the situation where we'd have to look at, you know, Alabama college football players. If they were making a salary, their salaries would be six figures, and then the Alabama tumbling team were making like $50 in a per diem. You know, because when you look at the amount of money that a football program makes versus the amount of money that, say, an equestrian program makes, it's not equal. And so to actually pay salaries would be an entire can of worms I don't even want to get into. But the name, image, and likeness thing, even if you are someone who doesn't belong to, Alabama football or Duke basketball or something like that, you can still make a respectable living by being a college athlete. Absolutely. You know, especially because you get a lot of things paid for by being a college athlete anyway. So being able to monetize your social media like ESPN suggests, or I've been really huge on athletes being able to do camps and being able to do those kinds of things that the pros do. And that would not only make some money for them, which they deserve, but it would also give back to these different communities, which would be great. I think this could potentially see a situation where college sports becomes more accessible, as, you know, some small town in West Virginia produces, let's say, a West Virginia basketball player, and he comes back and does a camp now in his hometown, and maybe you could find some more top-level collegiate athletes from that small town that previously had only produced one collegiate-ready player. So I really like... I love that idea. The whole issue with, I think it was the Florida Atlantic kicker or the Central Florida kicker a couple years ago, who had a YouTube channel. It was really successful, but the NCAA kicked him off the team told him that he would have to leave the team if he wanted to make money off that YouTube channel, which to me is just absolutely ridiculous because he earned it. Again, if you earn it, you should absolutely be able to collect the money. So this is exactly what I wanted to see happen. The name, image, and likeness is exactly what I wanted to see. I think there should be no restrictions on athletes being able to monetize themselves and earn money from what they've earned by being a collegiate athlete. I 100% believe that. Now, on the topic of where we end up going next, there's a lot of open space here. So if you watched our video talking about the Supreme Court decision in NCAA v. Alston, you'll know that the Supreme Court was not very impressed by the NCAA, by any of the NCAA's legal defenses to anything. And the Supreme Court allowed, or I should say, stripped back the NCAA's rules on academic payments. And I said that there was some potential issues that could arise from that. I believe that the NCAA saw that as well. They've seen these potential issues that could come up from the Supreme Court's ruling in that case. And so this may be a bone thrown by the NCAA to try to pare back those academic payment rules. And to be honest with you, I'd be okay with that. I think this, the name, image, and likeness stuff, is a lot more valuable than the academic payments that athletes might get, so-called academic payments that athletes might get. So if that's the strategy from the NCAA, I absolutely endorse that. And I'd be okay if they want to then pare back the academic achievement stuff that the Supreme Court had allowed. And I think the NCAA was reading the bigger picture here, which is that the Supreme Court, in their decision, again, I talked about this in the video, link is in the description if you want to go watch it. The Supreme Court said that the NCAA, they basically said, look, the NCAA has monopoly power. We would have the ability to break up the NCAA. We could change college sports entirely if we wanted to. But every justice on the Supreme Court, from Justice Kagan to Justice Thomas, every single one, on both sides, everyone, they said, we do not want to change college sports. So they really didn't want to. But in the decision written by Justice Gorsuch, they said, but we definitely could. They left that open. So the NCAA was feeling the legal pressure from the Supreme Court. They knew that if they took a case to the Supreme Court again, I think they knew that they would be in real trouble if there was another case involving the NCAA that got up to the nation's highest court. So I think they were feeling the pressure from there. I think they were feeling the pressure from Congress. Members of both parties of Congress have talked about doing some kind of national name, image, and likeness rules. Obviously, as I mentioned, several states have enacted name, image, and likeness legislation. So that heat's being felt by the NCAA. So this is good. The NCAA did respond to this. But moving forward, like I say, the only potential pitfall with the name, image, and likeness is that there may potentially be some kind of Title IX issues here. It's hard to say. But the only thing I could potentially see is if you did have, let's say Georgia football, they start running camps with their players, and it's the Georgia football camp, and they pay their players in order to come and teach at the camps. So if those players are getting paid, I don't know, let's say $5,000 to come and do that week-long camp, I'm just pulling out a number. Now, let's say Georgia runs a track and field camp and those athletes come out and they get paid $1,000 to do their week camp. So the football players obviously are all male. The track athletes would be presumably about half male, half female. So is that a Title IX issue because Georgia runs the camp? If the athletes got together and just did the camp themselves and picked up their own sponsors, would they be allowed to do that? So there is potentially some pitfalls here when it comes to Title IX. I'm sure there will be a lot of debate about this, but all I can say is I think of this as a huge step in the right direction. I was reading the statements by the NCAA, I'm reading these articles, and I'm saying, okay, what's the catch? Like, what did they not give? What's the issue? And there really isn't one. I mean, it's literally just exactly what we wanted from name, image, and likeness rules. Which I'm very surprised. I say I'm surprised. In a way, I am, but in a way, again, I think the NCAA is feeling the pressure, so I'm not really that surprised. Now, long term, when we talk about a sustainable way to do college athletics, what needs to happen is every state in the union needs to eliminate all of their name, image, and likeness legislation. They have to eliminate it. The federal government, Congress, cannot take up any kind of name, image, and likeness legislation. Because the NCAA will do this, the NCAA must do it alone. It would be an absolute nightmare if different states had different rules about how much money you could make or what you could endorse or what, you know, all this kind of stuff. It would be a nightmare. So that stuff all needs to go. The NCAA needs to have one nationwide rule that every one of its member schools follows. And that needs to be the only standard that exists. And the NCAA will do that knowing that if they don't, there will be state or even worse, federal legislation talking about name, image, and likeness. And that is the last thing that the NCAA wants at this point. Mark Emmert even said that in his statements talking about this new legislation from the NCAA. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, this right now, this needs to be enough. I know that there is a tendency today when we see, when we as fans get something we want more. Because we look at the NCAA and we say, okay, so they're willing to negotiate, so now let's go for more. And in this case, the more would be salaries for the athletes. No, no. The name, image, and likeness is enough. In my opinion, salaries would absolutely destroy college sports. It really would. And there's so many concerns. Title IX, I've talked about this before. The Title IX concerns of salaries are unthinkable. I mean, you want to talk about overloading every single court in the nation with litigation, talking about athlete salaries. I mean, it would be a nightmare just on that level alone. But then talk about the nature of college sports, what it's supposed to be. Remember, athletes are supposed to be getting an education. Okay, that is still the goal here. The idea is that if you excel at sports, we will allow you, we will pay for you to come here and get an education, to get a first-rate education, to go to school, and an opportunity that for many athletes they may not have had they not excelled at sports. So this name, image, and likeness is just basically a way to open the free market to say that, look, aside from going to school, you are now allowed to make money off yourself, which you should be allowed to do because you've earned this spot. So this is separate, but college sports should still be about going to school, getting an education. We've all seen the commercials about only 2% of college athletes play professional sports or whatever number it is. So we cannot treat college sports as a profession because it would totally destroy the entire point of doing college sports. So if you have a different opinion, let me know in the comments, but I am very firm on that. I've really come to believe that paying salaries to athletes would destroy college sports as we know them. And the alternative, what it would create, is not one that we would actually want. So for me, the issue that we should deal with going forward is not how much athletes are getting paid. At this point, we should deal with the issue of what is the quality of the education they're receiving. So I think there are things that the NCAA should look at in terms of how strictly is attendance, mandatory attendance in classes being taken, how much time are athletes actually spending in the classroom, how intense are their tutoring sessions, you know, really getting in there and figuring out, are our athletes actually getting the education that we are paying for them to get? Because anecdotally, the athletes that I have talked to, it is very difficult to receive the education that you would want to receive, that a normal non-athlete student would receive. I've told this story before about a woman that I worked with when I was in college, and she was an athlete, and we both wanted the exact same thing. We wanted to go in the exact same field, but for me, not being an athlete, I was able to devote all my time to my future job prospects, and she was not. She had to work twice as hard as I did just to get to the point that I was at in terms of, you know, increasing those future job prospects. So that to me needs to be the future of what we talk about when it comes to the future of college athletics. Salaries should be off the table. That was the kill shot, because salaries would have destroyed the NCAA. So the NCAA has done what we want them to do. So we should now reward them with taking salaries off the table. No one should call for it. We shouldn't be requesting it. That should not be in the lexicon right now for college sports fans. The name, image, and likeness thing is enough. So we need to make sure, remember this, the NCAA said this is temporary, just in terms of the legislation itself is not the permanent wording. They haven't figured out all the loopholes and all the legalese and the things like that. So we need to make sure that whatever the final bill is that is adopted by the NCAA, it's exactly what we want to see. And I really believe that it will be, because again, the NCAA is feeling that pressure. So we reward them by not talking about salaries and by dropping all of these government regulations on name, image, and likeness. Let the NCAA deal with this itself. If it's willing to do it, we should let it. And then our discussion needs to shift to the quality of education that athletes are receiving. So if you have any other opinion on this, or if you just want to celebrate one of the biggest wins for college athletes in the last, I don't know, four decades or so, then go down into the comments. Let's talk about it. I really want to hear some of your guys' opinions on this. I know that there's going to be a wide variety of opinions all over this issue. So I would love to hear some of that. That's in the comments. Thank you so much for joining us and watching through this whole video. I really, really appreciate it. Subscribe if you are interested in this stuff. I love talking about these topics. This will not be the last video I do talking about this name, image, and likeness legislation. I can absolutely guarantee you that. So I'll see you in the comments. Hit that subscribe button. We'll see you next time. I appreciate you.